Today you're gonna learn everything you need to know about GDP. This is the agenda for today. So GDP, what does it stand for? It stands for Gross Domestic Product. When the country publishes the GDP, they are basically publishing the market value of all the stuff that is produced by the country. This includes things like products, services. So what does this tell you? It tells you how well an economy is doing right now. In other words, it gives you an idea of what's the current economic health of the country that you're monitoring. So keyword is current economic health. Current economic health, not future economic health, because it is published quarterly. It lags behind the economy for about 4 months plus. Think about this. Of course, some people will say that this is a coincident indicator, but definitely this is not a leading indicator that you should use to predict what is going to happen in the future. But with that said, it is not completely useless because lagging indicators have their time and place. So if the big boys are looking at it, you should look at it too. So who are the people that are looking at GDP, observing GDP? You have the banks, world banks, central banks, government looks at it, hedge funds look at it. Now if you're talking about hedge fund traders, okay, they use GDP as a gauge as to whether their prediction in the past was correct or not. Because let's say 6 months ago, they were using some leading indicators to predict, okay, what's going to happen 6 months later. So in order to gauge whether their prediction is correct or not, they look at GDP. So it's like a report card for their own economic prediction. So government use it to determine their spending plans, how much are they going to spend, and also their tax plans, which is important as well. And of course, media also talk about it a lot. And of course, economists who publish the data for you. There are two types of GDP you need to know. Number one, nominal GDP. Number two, real GDP, which is the most important one. But you need to learn both, okay? So how is GDP computed, calculated? Let's say you have a country only has two types of people, game addicts like me last time, and bookworms. Because of that, this country only sells two types of stuff, books and games. Let's say their books sell for about 20. So this year, 200 worth of books is produced in the country. And then their games sell for, let's say, $30 because, you know, GTA is expensive. And because the country has more game addicts than bookworms, so they're gonna produce more. So let's say 600 worth of games, 200 plus 600 total nominal GDP is $800. Now you realize that I said produced, not sales. Because what GDP measures is not the amount of sales, but the amount of products that is produced. So even though a country doesn't sell any of their books, is just inside the storeroom, inside the inventory, it is still counted into the GDP. If next year, this country realizes that people like games so much that the bookworms became game addicts, more people are buying games in the country and hence they are going to increase or decrease price. Increase their prices. Let's say they increase it to $60. But then the amount of produce remains the same. Do you realize what happened to the total? Total nominal GDP, 1,400. Now, as a general guideline, if you don't know the basics, when GDP goes up, it is good for the economy and hence good for the currency. When GDP goes down, it is bad for the economy and hence bad for the currency. So if GDP goes up just because of an increase in prices, does this mean that the economic condition improve? No. So there's a problem with nominal GDP because it is not adjusted for inflation, the increase in prices. So that is why what we should look at is real GDP. Okay, because what real GDP does is that it is going to take the prices for a base year. This means that if we want to keep price constant, we will take prices for, let's say 2020 as the base year and keep the price constant, so that the only variable that can change is the amount of stuff that is produced, so that we can get a proper number. So if in 2021 we measure using real GDP, and in 2021 the amount of games produced increased to, let's say, 80, so we keep the price constant because we are measuring using real GDP, hence the total games produced would be 2400 worth of value, and hence total would be 2600. If you add together, we know that the amount of products, services produced increased, and hence this will potentially benefit the economy, because the price increase doesn't mean that it's going to benefit consumers. You know what I'm saying? That is a very simple way of calculating GDP. In the real world, as you know, things are a lot more complicated than that. But two very common ways in which GDP is computed is through expenditure approach and also income approach. Expenditure meaning amount of spending. So the formula goes something like this. Consumption, consumer consumption, C plus investment expenditure by businesses on plants and equipments, plus government spending, plus net exports. Exports minus imports, okay? Why do you minus off imports? Because we want to take into account stuff that is produced within the country, because if the stuff is produced outside of the country, then it is not considered. How about if it's income approach? Let's make things simple, okay? Let's say for the games, you take into account who are the people earning money from producing the game. Let's say per game, you pay a game developer $6 to develop the game. So $6 plus some material costs to do the packaging and all that stuff. Let's say it's $2 for the packaging, and then some overhead costs, like $1. So income approach, amount of income that is earned by people for producing the game would be $9. So this is the income approach. So basically, that's how you calculate it. But in the real world, things are a little bit more complicated. As you already know, if you have watched my previous economic indicator videos, you cannot take the number as it is, because first thing first, in the industry, there's massive conflict of interest. Second thing is that this is a lagging number. Third thing is that even for real GDP, it will tend to understate what is happening in the economy, because you need to understand that GDP doesn't take into account of a lot of things. For example, if you sell your second-hand stuff, it is not counted into GDP. If you are a gold digger, you marry a mechanic because you're just sick and tired of paying other people to fix your car all the time. And when your husband fixes your car every single week, you don't need to pay him, right? If you need to pay him, divorce him. If you create your own garden, you plant cabbage, vegetables in your backyard, that is also not counted into GDP. And of course, things like underground transactions, all that, of course, is not considered. And even things like buying stocks, buying assets, buying bonds, financial assets in the market is also not considered. If you own a business, but it is based overseas, also not considered. And also things like transfer payments, also not considered. Your social security, then your unemployment benefits. So how do you interpret this number? First thing first, you look at the number in itself. Is it positive, negative, or constant, flat? So positive, if everything remains the same, it's good for the currency, good for the economy, then potentially there will be an increase or rising interest rates. And hence, this will cause capital to flow into the country, and hence when investors exchange their foreign currencies to US local currencies, then the demand for the currency is going to increase, and hence the currency is going to benefit from it. Very important, absolute number is not the most important thing. It is not the number in itself that is important. What is important is what? How does the market relate to expectations? That is what matters most. So first thing first, look at the number in itself. Second thing, compare it with market expectations. Third step, you need to look at the overall trend, because you cannot just look at 1 month data, because if you learn statistics, the sample size 1 month, it is just not representative. It can be distorted by seasonal factors, many other factors, right? So you need to look at the overall trend. Is the economy in the big picture growing steadily, or is it growing too fast? Is it contracting steadily, or is it contracting too fast? And it's very important for you to look at the long-term trend, because you need to know that a lot of the economic indicators, they are positively correlated to a percentage real GDP growth. For example, if you look at PPI, seasonally adjusted numbers, in the long term, you realize that there's a positive correlation between PPI, seasonally adjusted, with percentage real GDP growth. So for GDP, there are three types of releases. So which one is more accurate? You have the advanced release, which is the first release, followed by prelim final release. This is a revised figure of advanced release. This is a revised figure of prelim release. Number one, number two, number three, which one do you think is more market moving? Now, the thing is, there's a difference between market moving and accuracy. Which one is more accurate? Which one is more market moving? Final figures, it is revised, right? So hence, it is most accurate. But the one that produces the most volatility and impact is advanced figures, because it is released before this and this. And markets would tend to digest the data from here. So by the time the final release comes out, even though it is more accurate, people will be like, I already know. So unless there's a significant difference in final values, prelim values, it's not going to move the markets that much. Markets are not completely rational, and they are going to react on whatever comes out first. GDP is released on a quarterly basis, which is why it is lagging, except for Canada, because they release it monthly, and hence it can produce a pretty significant impact, especially if it deviates too much from consensus. So what a lot of people don't know is that they can use GDP for a lot of different things. You can use GDP to determine inflation, and you use GDP deflator to calculate. Basically, this is nominal GDP divided by real GDP. You can also compare GDP of different countries, but there's one problem, because different countries have different population. Hence, if a country has more people, then the GDP is going to be higher. So in order to make the comparison fair, you need to look at GDP per capita. So if you want to compare the GDP of US with UK, then you use GDP per capita. The formula goes something like this: GDP of that country divided by the population of that country, and hence you will have a fair comparison. If this is all a little bit confusing to you, then maybe you need to work on your economics basics or fundamental analysis basics. I've done a video in the past. You can go and check it out. Okay, so with that, talk to you in the next video. Bye.